Hi, I am Sébastien Deleuze. I work for VMware as a Spring Framework Committer, and today I am pleased to announce Spring Native Beta version 0.9.0. It provides support for compiling Spring applications to native executables using the GraalVM Native Image Compiler. Native images provide an interesting alternative deployment option with different characteristics compared to the GVM, such as instant startup, instant peak performance, and reduced memory consumption. While it is still considered as experimental, beta means that we now provide support on a subset of Spring dependencies and that we will provide migration paths for future breaking changes. Another big change is the introduction of the Spring AOT, Maven, and Gradle plugins that allow to perform ahead of time transformations to improve both native image footprint and compatibility. Andy and Brian will share more about that later. But Spring Native Beta also means that you can now directly add native support from start.spring.io. And I would like to thank Stefan Nicole from the Spring Boot team for implementing that. Let's see a demo. Okay, so let's try this new native support. So just go to start.spring.io or use your favorite IDE integration and add the Spring Native dependency, which is now available. If you generate a project here, a Maven project, you will see that start.spring.io is automatically defining the current Spring Native version, adding the Spring Native dependency, configuring the Spring Boot Maven plugin in order to generate a native image inside the container image. And it also configures the Spring AOT Maven plugin. This is a plugin that will perform ahead of time transformation in order to create the native configuration, or will generate some code really designed for your application with its ClassPath and its configuration. But yeah, there is more. If you are adding, for example, a dependency that is not yet supported by Spring Native, and if you generate your project, you will see that in help.md file, you will have a customized documentation that will warn you about that dependency not being supported yet. So I think that's pretty useful. So be sure to check this file when you are creating a new project. You can also add GPA support. And when you do that, you will see that start.spring.io is doing an additional step for you. It's configuring Hibernate bytecode build time creation instead of runtime creation with this Hibernate enhanced Maven plugin. So again, the goal is to have something that works out of the box with native. Gradle is also supported, so just select Gradle. You have the Spring Native dependency, and you will see that the Gradle version of the AOT plugin is configured. The Spring Native dependency is configured. The same boot build image is configured, and yeah, it should work out of the box. So yeah, try it, send us feedback, and enjoy.
Hi, I'm Andy Clement, a director on the Spring team. Now, the native image building process is trying to build the most optimal image possible for your application. This means as the image is built, parts of the JDK you aren't using will be thrown away, parts of your dependencies libraries that you aren't using will be discarded, even parts of your own application will be discarded if we can work out we don't need them. Resources won't be included if you're not loading them, and metadata about classes won't even be included to satisfy reflection calls unless absolutely necessary. Now, to manage this, GraalVM Native has a sophisticated static analysis system. But it has limitations. Some Java facilities like Reflection make static analysis difficult, and it doesn't understand how frameworks and libraries might be using those to implement their own behaviors. For this reason, you can configure the native image build process via JSON files that will cause it to include extra material in the image that static analysis might be missing. This is where Spring Native fits in. It is helping the native image build process understand Spring applications. Spring Native knows how Spring Boot autoconfig works, it knows what dependency injection is, it knows simple things like application.properties needs to be included so that the application will be able to initialize itself on startup. So when you're using Spring Native, you are getting a form of static analysis like the GraalVM version, but this one is with a Spring slant on it. And the output of that is a series of those JSON config files that feed into the later native build process. Now, although the key knowledge, the high-level concepts of Spring are built into Spring Native, it needs to be an extensible system. If you think about the needs of all the different kinds of auto configuration out there, they'll be loading different specific resources, accessing different proxies or reflexive types. And there are always new auto configs being written that need new facilities. So we need an extensible system to support that variation. So what we have is a hinting system. So I'm just going to show you what that looks like. Just before you see a hint, this is what a Reflect config file looks like. So this is a typical file that you might maintain yourself. Native image build process can take these as input. This is saying I want reflective access in my image to command line runner and Spring application. And for this one, I want to see all the constructors and all the methods. And for this one, I want to see a specific method when I do reflection. If you can be specific, it's important to be specific to keep the image size down, keep the memory usage down. This file has a couple of problems. I don't like to see type names encoded in strings. It's a lack of type safety. If things start changing names, suddenly this file is out of date and you don't know that. You also lose context over time. For example, this file is only 20 lines long. I've seen files of 10,000 lines long. And if I look at that file again in 6 months' time, I'll wonder, why on earth is this particular type? Why do we need reflective access to it? There's nothing in here to tell you why that is. So we tried to tackle those two problems with the hint system that we built in Spring Native. So this is a native hint that you can write in Spring Native. It's quite simple conceptually. Basically, there is a trigger that will cause it to activate, and then there is a set of stuff that it will then drop into the image via dumping it into those JSON config files. So here we have a trigger of task execution auto config. If that is seen by Spring Native as active in this application, then this will happen in the config files. So this is very much the data you saw in that JSON file I just showed you. It's saying I want reflective access to a type, and this is what I want to see, all the class object and all the constructors. So if this hint fires, that information will be captured in a JSON config file that then feeds into the build system. We got the type safety we wanted. We've also got the context we wanted. If in 6 months I wonder, why is thread pull task executor in my image? I can't find it here. I say, oh, it's because of task execution auto config. So if it's time to review, then I can go and take a look at that and see if it's still important, still necessary to have this entry. There are a million things you can do with hints. Everything you can do in a JSON file can go in here. Proxies, resources, types, options, initialization settings, everything. So I'm not going to go any deeper into that now. I encourage you to go and check out the docs. Now, when we started Spring Native, it was plugged into the native image build process in GraalVM, and they worked together to build an image. As we started coming up with optimizations we wanted to put in to produce better images, we realized some of those optimizations would benefit not only people building native images, but even just regular Spring users happy to run on a JVM. So what we've done is we've pivoted in this 0.9 release, and we've pulled Spring Native away from the native image builder and pushed it earlier in the process. And what we have now in 0.9, if you look in Spring Native, is an AOT, ahead of time framework, that runs at the end of normal project build. And here I'm talking about when you build your Java into bytecode, the regular build. There is an AOT framework that can kick in at that point and do stuff. And that might be calling Spring Native to generate native image configuration files, or it might be generate some Java code and compile it to optimize Spring startup later. So I'm going to hand it over to Brian, who's going to go in a little deeper on this AOT framework. Thanks.
Hey, I'm Brian. I'm usually working on the Spring framework and Spring Boot projects, especially on the web-related features. Lately, I've been involved with the Spring Native project because we needed to work on a specific problem. As you probably know, Spring Framework is very flexible, and Spring Boot is great at turning developer opinions into runtime configuration for your application. In the native world, offering all that flexibility at runtime comes at a cost: the native binary size, memory usage, and compilation time. As framework developers, we wanted to solve that problem in a way that empowers the community, but at the same time is sustainable from a maintenance perspective. This is why, as of 0.9, Spring Native ships with a new ahead of time module. This AOT module is in charge of two things. One, it would look out at the application's opinions, like the class path and the configuration file. And two, using that information, we will generate additional Java sources and static resources. With those additional files, we can not only streamline the Spring startup process by pre-computing configuration and more, but we can also drive the GraalVM native compilation to be more efficient. Of course, this is all done for you thanks to our new Maven and Gradle build plugins. If you add them to your application, they will configure the AOT processing for the main sources, but also the test sources. This process is fully transparent, and you can check out the generated sources and even debug them. You can check out the reference documentation if you want to know more. We're experimenting right now with this new approach, and we're very happy with the results so far. If you get a chance to try it out, let us know what you think.
Hi, my name is Jens Schauder. I'm part of the Spring Data team. And of course, if you want to write serious applications, you need some kind of persistence. Maybe Java Persistence API, probably wrapped behind Spring Data JPA. And you can use that with Spring Native. Just additional to the Spring Native dependency, add Spring Data JPA to the dependencies on start.spring.io, and you're ready to go. Just one warning though, we tried to make it work. We didn't try it yet to make it small, so the image size is a little bigger than we would really like. But that's about to be improved in future versions. And if you don't like JPA, there are other modules available as well. MongoDB, both imperatively or reactive, R2DBC, Spring Data JDBC, Neo4j, Elasticsearch, and I think I forgot Redis. They are all there, ready for you to try out. So give them a spin.
Hi, I'm Ria. I'm a maintainer on the Spring security team. We want to make sure you can build all your applications securely. So of course, we've added Spring security support in Spring Native. Let's talk about what we've been working on so far. You can secure your application using form login or HTTP basic authentication. We also have support for OAuth2, both client and resource server. If you want to write your application in Kotlin, go ahead, that's supported. And if you're using RSocket, we have support for that as well. Now, if you've been with us for a while, you may remember that you had to add the enable all security services flag to the native image command in order to have Spring security work. You no longer have to add that manually, since we have hints that will automatically add it for you whenever they detect Spring security. If you want to get started, head over to the Spring Native project on GitHub and check out the security samples.
Hi, my name is Dave Sire, and I work for VMware. I'm on the Spring team, and I've been helping the Spring Native team to get up to speed and integrate with bits of Spring Cloud. And so I wanted to show you some of that today. So here's the project on GitHub. And there are a bunch of samples you can see, and some of them have the word cloud in them. Some of these are work in progress. One of the first things we did was the sort of serverless use case. So that's using Spring Cloud Function. And we've got three samples here. One of them is for a Lambda, AWS Lambda deployment. It's a custom runtime. And there are two basically functionally equivalent examples called Cloud Function Netty. One of them is annotation based and the other one is functional configuration instead of using annotations. So actually what I'm going to do is just show you the plain Netty one in an IDE. Here we go. And there's the application. It's just a Spring Boot application. I could run it here from the IDE if I needed to, and it would open up a port, an HTTP port on 8080, and I could interact with it locally. The way it works is it has a single component which is of type function, and it's a function from string to string, but I could have done, you know, POJO to POJO or business object to business object. And so what we want to do here is we want to build a native image, and the easiest way to do that is to use the Spring Boot plugin. So we'll give that a couple of minutes to finish. So it's almost finished. It's come back and it's told me that it has built a container. Cloud Function Netty. So let's see if we can run that with Docker. Here's my Docker command. I'm going to run it with port 8080, and there's the Docker image name. So that runs, starts up in about 45 milliseconds, and now we can interact with it just using curl. So here we go. Here's a curl command. I'm curling, sending it in Dave with a content type, text plain, and printing a new line at the end. Okay, and it sent me back, "Hi Dave." That's what I asked it to do, so that's good. So what did I have to do to get that to work? I had to just take a normal Spring Boot, Spring Cloud Function application, and then I added a dependency, Spring Native, and a plugin, Spring AOT Maven plugin. And the other thing I did was I've configured the Spring Boot Maven plugin to make that native image. So there's a flag that you can set to do that. You could look in the parent POM to find that. So I could take that image that I've got now and I could deploy it, for instance, on Google Cloud Run, or if I wanted to use AWS Lambda to make it into a Lambda, I've got to add the Spring Cloud Function AWS adapter to the class path, but I don't have to change the source code. So that's all I was going to show in the demo. There are some other features that you can explore there. There's Spring Cloud Config Client, Spring Cloud Config Server. There will be more features added as we start to do more releases of the Spring Native library. So thank you very much.
Hey, so let's talk about the roadmap now. 0.9 beta release has allowed us to set up this new AOT infrastructure that unlock a lot of new possibilities. We are going to publish a 0.9.1 bug fix release. We are already starting to work on 0.10. So 0.10 is a pretty big one as well, because it will be about transforming app configuration to functional configuration based on constructs like Lambda or method references. And that's pretty important for our support, because this kind of programmatic construct is automatically recognized by GraalVM Native Image Compiler. And that will allow us to remove a lot of reflection trees that we are currently using for the configuration, leading to better compatibility and smaller native images. Thanks for following us. Feel free to test the native support on star.spring.io. You can report bug fixes on the Spring Native GitHub repository. And feel free also to contribute to support for your favorite Spring Boot starters or other dependencies if you want to do that. Thanks.